It's very good to have you here this morning, and any other visitors as well this morning. It's good to be in the house of the Lord. This morning, we'll, I guess, give the screen a couple minutes. I'll do my little intro here. So this morning, God brought me to the word faithfulness, but not in the way that we normally think about faithfulness. I think we all know that God is faithful, and we know that what God is, we are to be as well. And this morning I'm going to be talking about our call to be faithful servants of the call that God has put on our lives. So this morning we're going to start at 1 Corinthians 9, verse 24. 1 Corinthians 9, verse 24 says, "Do you not know that in a race all the runners run, but only one gets the prize? Run in such a way to get the prize." And that's what we're going to be talking about this morning, is running in such a way to finish the race. In Hebrews 12, verse 1, it also says, "And let us run with perseverance the race that's marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, who is the pioneer and perfecter of our faith." And in Acts verse 20, or chapter 20, verse 24, it says, "My only aim is to finish the race and to complete the task that the Lord Jesus has given to me." So this is our call to be faithful, our call to finish the race that we've been given. And we all know that God is faithful. It's actually mentioned, I think I read over 250 times in the Bible, that God is faithful, or that he was faithful to his Israelites or to his people, or to in each and every stage of the Bible, God continually is faithful. We can probably list off a few, but just a few here for your reference. Deuteronomy 7 verse 9, we says, "Know therefore that the Lord your God is God, and the faithful God he is." And Psalm 36 verse 5 says, "Your steadfast love, O Lord, extends to the heavens, and your faithfulness to the end of the generations." Amen. God is faithful.
Amen.
So I find we've been talking a lot in our Bible study, and we have, I guess I've studied a few times over the last few years, in whatever Jesus is, that's what we're called to be as well. So you can look at any attribute of God and take that on to yourself and say, that's what I should aim for. That's what I should try to be as well. And we all know that God is a faithful God. And I think it's God is the standard. Jesus is the standard. He lived a perfect life, and we are to aim to be that. So if he is faithful, doesn't that mean I should be faithful as well? If you open your Bibles to Galatians 5, verse 22 and 23, it's a very popular verse. You don't really need to open it. It just says, "But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control." It's funny, I was preparing my notes for the sermon, getting everything together, really banking on this one scripture to be there, and I wasn't sure if faithfulness was a fruit of the Spirit. I was like, it kind of gets lost in the middle there. Yeah, everybody knows joy, peace, patience, and self-control, which is the last one, but the four or five in the middle, people tend to kind of not really realize that it's there, but it is there. So one of the fruits of the Spirit, one of the things in your life that will be evidence that the Spirit is in you, is faithfulness. And God calls us to be faithful with what he's given, whether it's our finances, whether it's a dream he's put on our life. And that's something that's really, he's been stirring up in me these last few weeks, is if he's called you to something, if he's prophesied something over your life, if he's set before you a dream, a goal, a vision, don't let it peter out and die. We've been called to be faithful with what we've been given. So if God has prophesied over your life that you will, be the manager of the company you work for and run the company, and he's set that call, that dream, that hope over your life, and you're one or two years in and you're still not there, and you think, oh, was that God talking? Was that God who wanted me to do that? The devil is going to be trying his best to make you forget the dreams that God has for your life, to forget the call that he has on your life, so that you will probably not achieve it. So we are called this morning to be faithful, not only faithful with what he's been given us, but faithful to what he's put in our hearts to see through to completion. And Pastor Anita mentioned something about that. That's kind of where this sermon was kickstarted was Pastor Nita a few weeks ago was talking about being a finisher, being somebody who follows through. So obviously us in our church here, we're comfortable, we're here in the church, in the building, all is good. But if we're not going to finish the project, see it through to completion, be faithful, then we're maybe missing out on the largeness of what God has in store. So let's be encouraged to be faithful with all that God has given us, even the dreams and the visions He's put on our life. But some of you might be asking, but what if I've dried up? What if I've lost the vision? What if I don't have the overflowing life, the overflowing water of Jesus in me to continue on this dream or this vision? So I've called this point, but what if I've dried up? And it comes from Ezekiel 37 verses 1 to 10. I'm not sure if we're able to get that one up there. It's the story of the dry bones. So it says, "The hand of the Lord was on me." So this is Ezekiel speaking here. "And he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord and set me in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. He led me back and forth among them, and I saw a great many bones on the floor of the valley, bones that were very dry. He asked me, 'Son of man, can these bones live?' And I said, 'Sovereign Lord, only you alone know.' And then he said to me, 'Prophesy to these bones and say to them, dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. This is what the Lord says to these bones. I will make breath enter you, and you will come to life. I will attach tendons to you and make flesh come upon you and cover you with skin. I will put breath in you and you will come to life. Then you will know that I am the Lord.' So I prophesied as was commanded, and as I was prophesying, there was a noise, a rattling sound, and the bones came together, bone to bone, flesh to flesh. I looked, and tendons and flesh appeared on them, and skin covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, 'Prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, son of man, and say to it, this is what the sovereign Lord says. Come, breathe from the four winds, and breathe into these slain, that they may live.' So I prophesied as he commanded, and breath entered them. They came to life and stood up on their feet, a vast army." So if God can do that to physical life, he can do that to anything he's put into your life. So the first answer, or the first point to what should I do if I've dried up, would be to declare what has been lost as if it is. Declare what has been maybe dried up and has died as if it were full of life and full of breath. And so if you have areas in your life in which you're just needing a breath, a push, an oomph from the Lord, just declare what is not as if it were, and just speak that into each and every dream. So if there's something you're thinking about this morning, I just want to give you guys a moment just to think, what is God calling me to? What does God have in store for me? What is God maybe opening a door for that I've let shut? Or what has God maybe put into my life that I can take to the next level, that I can fulfill, that I can be faithful with to see this dream come to completion? I just want you all to just kind of dwell on that for a few moments, and we'll go through declaring, and then we'll go through a few other things that we need to do to just bring those dreams back to life, bring those visions back to life. I just thank you. Thank you, Jesus, for that. So the next thing we can do is we can acknowledge and we can seek. So I'm just going to rattle off a few scriptures here. So the first, Proverbs 16, verse 3 says, "Commit your work to the Lord, and your plans will be established." Matthew 6, verse 33 says, "But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you." Psalm 37, verse 4, "Delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart." And Proverbs 3, verse 6, "Acknowledge me in all your ways, and I will make your path straight." So all of these talk about putting God first. If you've feel like you're maybe running around. I've definitely had that in the last 6 months with just a lot of new stuff happening in life. You feel like you're running every which direction. And then when you sit back after maybe a month or two of trying your hardest and doing all that you can to make things work, and you realize, well, God was not first there. That was me trying to do what I thought was the most important. That was me putting what I thought needed to be done first. So I was running this left, right, and center, trying to do all this work, but not really sitting down and saying, God, what do you want for right now? What is your desire? Because when you put his desires before your own, he will give you the desires of your heart. Amen? Amen. So we had declare. Second, we had acknowledge and seek. And third, we have ask. Janelle, my wife, just bought us a new devotional this week, which has been amazing so far. Pastor Anita always mentions Smith Wigglesworth, and I've heard the name 100 times and thought it was a funny last name, but that's really all I knew about the guy. So we got a book, and it's really good so far. It's just a daily devotional by him. But the front cover says, which is just so profound for this, is God is more eager to answer than we ever are to ask.
Amen.
God wants to answer the questions you have. God wants to give you the desires of your heart. God wants to say, he's right there. He's ready to give you what you need, give you strength for the day, give you motivation to get through a week, give you joy in a hard time, give you life where there might be death. And he says he's more eager to give than we are to ask. And so maybe all we need to do is ask. I know it's a easy thing to say, a harder thing to do, but I just encourage you, if there's something that you're lacking or something that you need to get you through this vision, or maybe you're stuck at a crossroads or you're stuck at a valley along the way and God's really calling you forth, but you feel like you can't do it on your own, just ask. God is more eager to answer than we ever are to ask. And it says here in Romans 12, verse 12, rejoice in hope, be patient in tribulation, and be constant in prayer. Which I just want to encourage each and every one of you to do is rejoice in the hope that you have for the future. Be patient when you're in the hard time, when you're in the valley, when you're in the trial, and just be constant in prayer through it all. And fourthly, first we had declare, second we had acknowledge and seek, third is ask, and fourth is believe. All it takes is a little bit of faith, amen?
Amen.
So Matthew 17, verse 20, for truly I say to you, if you have faith like a grain of mustard seed, you will say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move, and nothing will be impossible for you. Last week, Anita said something that really stuck with me near the end of her sermon. She mentioned, she went on for a little bit, but she said, it's not going to turn to supernatural unless you step out in the natural. And I thought that was just something very profound in which sometimes we sit, sometimes we wait. Say, for example, God put he prophesied over my life that such and such would happen, and it's 2 years later and it still hasn't happened. And I'm just waiting, I'm sitting there saying, oh, God, when are you going to do that thing that you talked about doing? Like Anita said last week, sometimes it's us to take that step. Sometimes it's us to move from here to there so that God can do the rest. God is more than willing, like we just looked at, is more willing to answer than we are to ask, but he's also looking for us to take our step of faith as well. So I want to read to you Joel 2, verse 23 to 27. It says, be glad, people of Dorchester. It says, be glad, people of Zion, but we can take it on for our own today. Rejoice in the Lord your God, for he has given you the autumn rains because he is faithful. He sends you abundant showers, both autumn and spring rains. The threshing floor will be filled with grain. The vats will overflow with new wine and oil. I will repay for you the years the locusts have eaten. My great army that I sent among you, you will have plenty to eat until you are full, and you will praise the name of the Lord your God who has worked wonders for you. Never again will my people be ashamed. Then you will know that I am in Israel, that I am the Lord your God, and that there is no other. Never again will my people be shamed. So the Lord is declaring this over our life today. He will repay what has been lost. If you feel like you've been, maybe you missed out the last 5 or 10 years, maybe you, things in life got in the way and you really weren't able to fulfill. Say 5 years ago, God put a call on your life and you just haven't seen it through to completion. God will restore the years that the locusts have eaten. He will restore what has been lost. He will overflow your vats with oil and with wine. And if you believe that he can do so, if you say, I can do all things through him who strengthens me, it will be done, and he will restore the years that have been stolen from you. So I just encourage you in that. So some of you might be saying, well, what if I've been unfaithful? What if God put something on my life and I messed up, or I didn't do it, or I dropped the ball? Romans 3 verse 3 says, what if some were unfaithful? Does their faithlessness nullify the faithfulness of God? And I think we all know the next line, not at all. God is faithful even when we are not faithful. He is the all-powerful God, and he is more than willing to take you exactly where you are today and bring you to completion. He's willing, he's interested, he is eager to see you go to where he wants you to be, whether you've lost a couple years, whether he's put the call on your life this morning. No matter what it is, he wants to see that dream come to completion. And I just want to encourage you with Luke 16, verse 10. It says, one who is faithful in little is also faithful in much. So be faithful with what you have now. If you're not in the stage where God's given you the big stuff, be faithful with the little stuff. Be faithful with the commitments that you've committed to. If it's just one ministry or one financial donation or one person in your life that God's giving you the opportunity to witness to, be faithful with the little, and he will make you faithful with much. For with the measure you have been given, so you are received. So I just encourage you, Janelle and I have a little saying, which we say all the time, is one thing, then the second thing, then the third thing, then the fourth thing. You start with one thing at a time. You look at any situation and it's overwhelming, it's too big, it's maybe not what I can handle right now, but God's telling you, just take one step at a time. Just say, if you're faithful with little, I'll make you faithful with much. So just take that first step of faith and see where God's going to take you. And so you might ask, what is the prize? We said at the beginning, run in such a way to get the prize. And I'll invite the worship team to come on up as I close here. But the prize is, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. And the Lord will say to you, as in Matthew 25, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with little, and I will set you over much. Now enter into the joy of your master. So I just want to encourage each and every one of you that there's calls, there's dreams, there's visions, there's a destiny for each and every one of us, and God wants to see it through to completion. God wants you to be faithful with what he's put on your life, and I just want to encourage you with that. So would you all join me as we prepare to worship in our final song here, and just join me in prayer this morning. Father God, we thank you that you have been so generous to us, Father, that you've given us such opportunity each and every day to step into all that you have for us, Lord. And Father, whether we feel like we might have missed the boat, or we've missed our chance, or we've maybe missed the opportunity to fulfill the will of the Father, I just pray that you would open those doors, Father. Motivate those hearts, Father. Breathe life into each dry bone, Father, that they would just be able to each and every day strive to fulfill the will that you've put on their life, Lord. Father, help us to be faithful as you are faithful, Father. Help us to run the race, to finish the fight, to run in a way to get the prize, Lord, to say each and every day, I'm not in it for me, I'm not in it for the short term, Father. I'm in it for the long haul. I'm in it for you to see the call you've put on my life come to completion, Lord. And I just pray that each and every one of you would be encouraged with that. Thank you, Jesus.